مستر عمر كونسلر اوف ادفايزر اوف شيخ سلطان فور ذا هاير ايدوكيشن هيز اكسلنسي دياب الموسى ادفايزر تو هيز هاينس شيخ سلطان مي جاد سيف هيم مستر محمد بن جرش دايركتور اوف ذا يونيفرسيتي كامبوس principals directors of the Ministry of Education you are most welcome in this seminar in the 21st century skills teaching and learning Ms. Mahra is kindly requested to deliver her speech she is the director of the Regional Center for Educational Planning She is kindly invited to deliver her speech. In the name of God, the most gracious, the most merciful, peace be upon all of you, your excellencies, dear audience, brothers and sisters, dear guests, peace be upon all of you. I am pleased to welcome all of you at the beginning of the second seminar of this year for the Regional Center for Educational Planning on an issue which has been so mindful for the decision takers, namely teaching and learning of the 21st century skills. Everybody speaks about skills in this seminar. We'll discuss what are these skills, how to convey them to our educational system, how can we apply them in the system, the Regional Center for Educational Planning. These seminars conducted by RCEP has become one of the most important goals to be achieved by the center in order to promote knowledge regarding the educational planning. It is an institutional work. We prepare well for it through inviting experts and scholars for educational dialogue and also to involve the educational experts in order to reach recommendations for the development of education and to prepare for solving the problems in this century. These seminars embody many goals, namely development of education. The UAE comes at the top of the priorities of education, and the advanced education should adopt new issues and quit the traditional. We had traditional methodologies. We have to change the role of the teacher and the student. The UAE government has decided to develop the education and has put it on the top of its priorities to have a change in the outputs and to be much better in returns of the society and proceeds. The development should be planned and programmed and targeting based on a future vision and to direct it in order to serve the purposes of distinction and in order to develop the methodology of teaching and reviewing the objectives of education in line with the modern approach. We have to benefit from the international approach through this seminar. We prepare our children for work and in line with the 21st century's approach in this century and to adapt with the changes. We have been so keen to benefit the educational field from this, so we invited many directors and principals and decision makers in the Ministry of Education and everybody concerned with the education, the field of education. We will listen to the professors from the Emirates College for Advanced Education who are involved in these seminars and to benefit from the experiences available in the UAE and the higher education experts under the directions of Mr. Hussein Hammadi, Minister of Education, Chairman of the Center. We are looking for the discussions and the dialogues in this seminars and seminar in order to create a generation having great capabilities to help in pushing the progress in the UAE in line with the 21st century. Once again, I thank the guests and the experts, everybody who think that these issues are important for everybody. Thank you very much. Now, thanks to Ms. Mahra Al-Mutawi. Now I invite the lecturers, Dr. Mona Abu Asali, member of the staff of Omeris College for Advanced Education, Dr. Shafia Bint Abdul Rahman, member of staff of the Emirates College for Advanced Education.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
In that 21st century is coming with new challenges and new roles for the teacher and the students that need skills and criteria and need the educational skills to be put on the educational stages in order to prepare them for the future and the market and the labor market. What are the skills? What are the mechanisms through many disciplines? How to find out the students, find out them? Mrs. Mona Abu Asali will speak about the 21st children. What skills are missing? She is a member of the Emirates College for Advanced Education. She is holder of PhD in education from Exeter University. She holds masters in teaching English language from Shipping in Britain. She has 18 years experience in courses of teaching and the preparation of ITLS tests. Her researches are focused on developing the capabilities of teachers and the emotional status of the teachers and students.
ملاحظة اللغة العربية الشانل رقم 1 على الجهاز الورق بالإنجليزي.
Having a plastic toy. I remember my parents, you know, bringing me a farm with plastic animals, where I was the happiest in the world to get all those little things. I remember when I was a child that my father used to take me to the park just to play, to run, to cycle, and then to meet some friends, and I was the happiest at that time. So when I read the word children for this symposium, all the memories came into my mind, reminding me of how happy my life was and how simple it was. But now, look at our children here, the 21st children. What kind of children do we have? The children we have are very smart. The children we have are brilliant. The children we have are ready to learn. They are capable of doing many things that probably at those ages we were unable to do. So nowadays what we have is that children who are able to explore, who are able to use technology better than us, right? I remember that, you know, my little niece, she was in grade 2 and she was making fun of me still using the iPhone 4 now while people are using more advanced iPhones. And she was in grade 2. So our new generation, our new children have become more challenging for us. They have become more intelligent than we really expect. Our children nowadays have many skills, and those skills are really involved in our curriculum. So when I look at the title 21st century, I don't think that I need to define those skills. Every one of us know that those skills there are included in our curriculum. So we have the problem solving, we have the inquiry, we have the observation, and we ask our students to go and do experiments in the labs. We have them, you know, participating in projects. I've been involved with Hamdan Chaja Award for Academic Distinction for 7 years now. And I was always amazed by the brilliance we have in our children. I mean, if you look at their profiles, participating in science festivals, spellathon, you know, things for mathematics, experiments, science, they create projects, so they are really smart. But still, those children, you know, have many things that we want them to learn in our curriculum. And we have them in the curriculum. But still, we feel, and this is my understanding, that our children, those brilliant creatures, let's say, are still missing many things, right? What I think, personally, is that still we have problems in our schools, and we cannot ignore those problems. Though we have smart students, though we have brilliant students, though we have students who are academically successful all the time, we still, you know, suffer from attendance or absence problems in the schools. We still have students who feel shy in the classroom to participate. Even though as a teacher, you sometimes feel that my child is really awesome. At home, he's playing, he's acting, he's talking. In the classroom, he's completely different. He is very shy, he is hesitant, he doesn't want to answer even if he knows or if she knows the answer. So there must be something wrong, right? And also, I'm teaching now in a college where I teach students from B.Ed. 1, which is, you know, bachelor degree in year 1 till year 4, and still we have the same problem. I have students who are really so smart. They can, you know, academically successful in any subject. Once you ask them to come here to present, they will be shaking like a jelly. And you know as a teacher that those students have the potentials. They are capable. They have all the skills that we need in our future leaders, if we say, or our future teachers. And they lack, but still they lack the communication skills. They lack, you know, the self-esteem. They need someone to help to be able to unleash those skills and those potentials to prove themselves as good citizens. This is what we want in our 21st century. Everything, academically speaking, is there perfectly well designed. Everything we ask our students to do, they can do it, and they are capable of doing that. So, I think that, you know, if we have just a quick look at what research has said and what the media is saying nowadays about our children. Before I share this, yesterday I was really watching the news and I was shocked by the latest conference for the media in the Arab world, and they showed statistics about the use of media and devices and technology in our children nowadays in the ages between 15 and 18. And the number was shocking to me, that the ages between 15 and 18, they use text messages through WhatsApp and other devices like 5 billion per day. Billion, not million. And I was really shocked. This is a very big number, but what kind of texting our children are doing? What kind of messages they are sending outside to the people? This is really very interesting to us as educators, as teachers, as you know, supervisors, as school principals, as parents too. We need to know why our children are able to do this and they are unable to cope with the real life situations. The media, this is a funny picture that I found, and probably, I don't know, it might be true to you, that nowadays all parents, you know, they have their children having all the devices. All the devices and only the parent who the one who obeys, right? And yesterday, a funny thing happened while my friend and I were having lunch in the hotel. There were a couple behind us, and they have a toddler, a baby. Once she started crying, it was so interesting that he gave her his iPhone. And she was very happy, and she was calm and quiet. And she was only still, you know, in her first months. It's really amazing. So what the media says is that our children nowadays, they learn and grow at home, at society, in school. They are not growing only in our houses, not only with parents. And this is something we all know. So they grow, and they formulate all their formulas in their minds, their thoughts, their beliefs, their principles, their values. Everything doesn't come only from the school, doesn't come only from the parent, doesn't come only from peers. So it comes from everywhere surrounding those children. So this is really dangerous because you don't know how to measure the value of those children. So also our children, they are born lacking the social skills. How do they learn this? How do they learn to address a father or a mother? Some children address their fathers by first name, without a father or without mother. It's up to you as a parent to accept it or to take it. Other parents won't allow this. Some teachers also would allow their children to call them a mother or by name, right? So children develop all those feelings, to be happy, to be sad, to be angry, to be frustrated from the surrounding. This is also applicable to us as teachers, as educators. We grow up in a society where our culture teaches us when to be sad or how to be angry for what. Many things, you know, we learn, it's just cultural, right? So sometimes if you are in a situation, and that was something I faced when I interviewed my participants in my doctoral thesis, which was about emotional experiences. So they said to me, teacher, sometimes as a teacher, I feel angry just because I need to feel angry. Because if I don't, my friends will laugh at me that was a situation where you needed to be angry. Because culture-wise, you should be angry in this situation. So even our anger, even our satisfaction is developed throughout the culture, throughout the society. What about our children then? Research said that the children's success is not only defined nowadays by the IQ. For so long, we know that, you know, our companies, schools, institutions, they run tests for testing the IQ of a person or of a child. And if he or she proves to be highly intelligent, they would allow or admit to the school. For so long, the IQ was dominating our institutions, but not anymore. Because recent research proved that IQ only forms 20% of our success in life. So what our children lack is more than academic skills, more than academic or cognitive skills. We have all the skills for our children in the curriculum, and we are happy to a certain degree with their achievements in school. You as parents, or as teachers, or as school principals, you might feel proud of the achievements your children bring to you, gaining rewards in different parts of the Emirates here or even internationally. But still what I'm saying is that to be successful in life, we still need many things to teach our children so that they create the balance. So in this case, one of the scientists, Dr. Eric Sigmund, says that the children nowadays, at the age of 10, they are exposed to at least 5 types of screens in their surroundings. And as you see, iPads, iPhones, iBooks, screens, laptops, different, at the age of 10 only. which should ring a bell to us, right? So this is something that we as parents should not ignore, or we as educators should not ignore. So how much of these devices do we need our students to use? How much do we want them to use those devices in their classroom? And how do we want them to use those devices? If they are that intelligent, if they are technology savvy and they know how to play with it, how to text, how to send messages, how to look for information, we want to make sure that we are there to help, to observe, and to guide. So, also we have, this is a very dangerous thing, a research done by the Children Now organization. And they said that the children nowadays, they spend more time with their devices than any other activity. Just before they sleep, they just go and put their devices up. And many times parents discover that even if your child said, I'm going to bed, under the bed sheet, he or she will still be using the phone or still using the screen. Which is really something interesting, but we need to take care of. And another issue, what about our privacy nowadays? If our children are using Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, you know, they have the WhatsApp thing, my mother is cooking in the kitchen, my father has just arrived, and then they take a picture of the little child playing, here's my sister playing. What about our privacy? Isn't this risky and dangerous? Isn't this something that, you know, interfering with our privacy as a family? We need to watch this. We need to teach our students how to take care of those things. We need to teach our students the skill of learning about the ethics of things. So it is not ethical, for example, to go and take a picture of your mom while cooking in the kitchen and just spread it on the social media. You should take, if your mom is fine and you take her permission, it's fine. But you cannot do this while she's busy and then you just go to your friends and publish. So we need those skills that our children learn, not only in school. They need to learn this from their parents, from their teachers, from the school community, which this is something we look forward to have in our schools. So, another shocking fact is that research has shown that no matter what devices our children have, nowadays in school they become more lonely. And I'm quite sure that in your schools, parents or teachers sometimes complain of children who are disobedient to you, who will never listen to you. It's none of my business, they will say. Do whatever you want, this is me. You will have a children who will unable to control their anger, and their anger might, you know, transfer to their partners, to their peers in the class too. They might become very aggressive, having fights or having problems with other peers just because they're angry and they are unable to control their anger. So no matter how academically successful is this child, if he or she is unable to control the anger, so what kind of a leader or a prospective teacher we are expecting in the future? If he's dealing with larger group of people and more, you know, numbers of staff or teachers or students. So, something else. How many hours do we spend with our children? I remember one little child when I was in a visit for schools for 1 week that I needed to observe teachers. And the little child there was called Maria. And she was so sweet. She just came to me to give me candies or chocolate because I used to be in the classroom. But by the end of the week, I was surprised when she came to me crying. And she said, teacher, I want to tell you something. I said, go ahead. She said, I miss my father. And I said, is your father traveling? Is he abroad? She said, no. I said, so why don't you talk to him? She said, he's always busy. I said, busy doing what? She said, always busy. And even if I want to talk to him, he's on the phone. And he said to me, you are a big daughter now. You're a big girl. And big girls do not cry. Big girls do not ask for help. Go do it yourself. But I know, teacher, I'm still young. I was really impressed by her honesty and by the way she was expressing her feelings to me. Her father was there, and her father was at home, but he was unable to have this connection with his child, so she was looking for this connection outside. So I was only for 1 week, and she was trying to find someone who can listen or who can, you know, understand her feelings. that was really painful moment for me because I was able to help at that moment only. I was not at school all the time. So this also another thing for parents, a message for parents that you need to spend more time with your kids. So the message is, before I move to the other point, is that it's more important for us to teach our children skills that they need for life. It's not only that we need to take care of the cognition, of the technical skills. We need something more. We need them to be able to be socially, emotionally balanced. And how can we do this? I'm quite sure that all of you have heard of the emotional intelligence. Have you? Emotional intelligence. Why do we need emotional intelligence? Emotional intelligence doesn't mean that you are emotional all the time, crying or taking care of people. Because for so long in research, there was a long debate about, you know, the rationality, irrationality. So people who are emotional cannot take decisions. People who are emotional cannot be good leaders. Emotions are only for women, not for men. And of course, this is not true. We as teachers, we as educators, we as adults, we experience emotions every day, every minute. At work, how many times you feel happy that you start your day with a smile? Many times you are in school or in your classroom and you experience different emotions. Sometimes enthusiastic, your students have good answers. Sometimes depressed, your students are not doing the right job. Sometimes you are unsatisfied. Sometimes. So you experience a mixture of emotions at one time. So what about our children? If you are an adult and sometimes you say, no one feels what I feel, especially teachers, I know this. No one feels that I'm so sick today, but still I need to go to classroom. No one feels that, you know, I'm so really depressed, I'm so tired, but still I need to take care of my children. So if this is the case with us adults, what do you think of our children, little children who still are unable to recognize their feelings? We want this to happen in our classrooms. So emotional intelligence, as Daniel Goleman views it, it is, first of all, it's a human. All of us, you know, have emotions. It's a human. You cannot say, no, I'm not emotional, I'm rational, I take decisions at the right time. Fine. Even if when you want to take a decision, your emotions are there. Is this right? Is this wrong? Am I going to make those people happy? Am I going to, right? So your brain internally is working through emotions, even if you do not want to admit it, which is something that we need to think of. So Daniel Goleman, the one who developed the emotional intelligence theory from other, you know, people, from other theorists, Salovey and Mayer, he said that, you know, it is our ability to handle our feelings, to control our happy and negative feelings. So it is not always about negative feelings. We experience different feelings. Our students in the classroom, our children, sometimes they are very moody. Sometimes they are bad-tempered. And you as a teacher and an educator, sometimes you feel confused. How could I do this? How could I control this child? If I have 25 children, God, only God knows how this will happen. I don't know how to take care of every child. But it happens in our classrooms. It happens that our children, you know, are angry. It happens that they are unhappy with what you're doing. And sometimes you don't know whether you are the reason or the reason comes with the child from home. You don't know. Children, you know, act differently in your classroom. So we as teachers, we need to help them control their feelings, control their anger, control the way they are acting and collaborating with their peers. How can we do this? Goleman believes that emotional intelligence has five important components which we should take care of: self-awareness, managing emotions, motivation, empathy, social skills. Those are all skills in the emotional intelligence model. What does this mean to our children? If we said that they are academically successful, great. But if we talk about those skills, self-awareness, we need our children to learn to be aware when they are happy, to be aware of their feelings, to be aware that today I'm in a bad mood because this happened to me. We want the child to learn about feelings and learn how to express them to you. Not if you ask a child, what's wrong with you? Nothing. I don't know. We don't want this negativity to control our students. We want them to be able to manage their emotions. So it's okay if you are angry. Don't tell the children that, for example, you are a big boy. Big boys cannot be angry. No. Big boys or big others, you have the right to be angry. You have the right to be frustrated sometimes. But we need to teach our students how to take this anger further, to control it and be able to master the situation around you. Emotional intelligence is not just press a button, you are happy. No, it's not like that. It is not that we need our children to be motivated. Many of our children nowadays, they feel motivated in your classroom because you tempt them, you know, that if you do this good job, I will give you a candy. If you do this, if you be the first, you will get a star, right? This is fine. Those extra motivations are really perfectly well working in our classrooms. But for the 21st century and the challenges coming, we want our children to be internally motivated. We want them to believe in what they are doing. We want them to learn how to value not only homework, assignments, and projects. They want them to value education. They want them to value that coming to school. We want them to love school. How many of your children now in the school, if you ask, do you love your school? How many yes? How many, even you teachers, sometimes, right, if you are not motivated, internally motivated to go to the school, and you find all the support there, you might, you know, be unwilling sometimes to go. Today I'll be absent. I'm so sick. I'm tired. It's my right to take a sick leave, or it's my right just to stay at home. I am, you know, a human being, right? How many times we say this to ourselves? But unless we have this responsibility inside, unless we have this feeling inside that we are responsible of this generation, we need to teach, we need to do, we need to go, we cannot continue on our career as teachers or as educators, wherever we work. So we need to teach our students how to be internally motivated, not only externally motivated, because this will help them for the rest of their lives. We need to teach them empathy. We need them to learn how to empathize or sympathize with other children if they are sick. We need to teach them how to say something without hurting others or making fun of others. In our schools, many of the problems, I was in a meeting last week with some of the social workers. And one social worker told me that he works for a boys' school. And he said most of the time, most of the fights, because one of the children might make fun of the others. You are so and so, you are. So we need our children to grow up having all respect for the surroundings, having all respect for their teachers, for the school, for the values of education that we have there. Academics is not only enough. Cognition is not only enough. We need our children to learn social skills. How many teachers here ask our children in a morning, how are you feeling today? Do you ask your children this in the classroom? Or if, like adults, if anyone asks you, how are you? Alhamdulillah, fine. But this Alhamdulillah is only like automatic reply, right? It is Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah, we thank God for every minute, for every day, right? But if you want to take this further, sometimes you wish if someone will ask you, how was your night yesterday? How was your day? Are you okay? Are you doing well? Rather than this automatic, yes, I'm fine. We need to take this further, or even for 1 minute or 2 minutes, just to take things out of our chest, to feel that our feelings are appreciated or acknowledged by others. So if I say I'm tired, and I say, oh yes, I know how you feel when you are tired, just like few words, it might help you sometimes. Right? Our children need the same. They need this in our schools, in our classrooms. Yes, I agree that we have large numbers of children in school, like say 20, 25, and you as a teacher, it might be difficult for you to ask every child, how are you today? Okay? But if you are a teacher and you care, you can create a simple activity where they can draw for you, how do they feel today? And every child will tell you how do they feel. And then you can start your lesson. Why not? Okay. So emotional intelligence is not at the end is a score. It's a profile of different sets that we can work together. It is something that, you know, can be developed, can be pushed, can be enhanced. And if we talk about emotional intelligence, it's something in our religion. As Muslims, alhamdulillah, then we know that innama al-ilmu bil-ta'allum wa innama al-hilmu bil-tahallum. So things will come, or you, learning comes only by practicing learning. And for parents to be preparing person, you will learn this by only practicing how to be preparing, right? And then it is not the one, the strongest is the one who fights and wrestles, the one who controls anger, the one who knows when to say yes, when to say no, the one who knows how to deal with other people's feelings and how to deal with other people's frustrations or any other daily activities. Do we have this in schools? I'm not sure. In his recent book, Poulter, he said, How Children Succeed. Poulter believes that teaching our children is more than stuffing their minds with information, with skills, academic skills, observation, problem solving, all those skills, the 21st century skills. It's more than this. We need also to create set of qualities that our children need to learn. Set of qualities that would guarantee our children will be successful leaders, successful teachers, successful members, successful citizens in society. We need to teach them how to be persistent, not, you know, after they graduate, they will be in one job like 1 year, 2 years, and then khalas, they will just forget about it and try to think of another job. We need to create the ethics. We need to teach them that we have more valuable things in life like than getting a job or getting a promotion or getting a seat like a VIP person. It's really great to have people, you know, having those qualities, academic and social emotional skills. Last month, I was in a conference in Abu Dhabi about the organizational learning. Organizational learning, and Professor Macy said a very nice, interesting sentence. He said, we hire people for skill, but we fire them for the lack of emotional skills. It was really interesting because no matter how academically successful a person is, we have many leaders, we have many people in a leadership position who can be excellent handling meetings, running, you know, workshops, giving or making decisions, but still they lack the social skills how to talk to their staff. And those our children will become in those positions one day. So if we do not take care of our children and we prepare them for the market, as we say, and we prepare them for the future, I don't know how much we aspire and how much we expect from those children, from those future adults. So again, we say that for the emotional intelligence, if we want practical steps, before we start anything, we need to show students models. So before I ask my student to be caring, I need to be caring as a teacher. Before I ask my student to control anger, I need to control my anger as a teacher, and not from the very first moment the child misbehaves, I will send him or her to the back of the class for punishment. Or as I see in some of the schools, we have a chair like punishment chair, which something I did not like, but though it seems that it works with some children. I don't know why. But I think we need to be more positive and more hopeful that our children need a better education in terms of emotions, social emotions, and academics. So what I want to say is that our children, having those skills, preparing them for 21st century, needs more from us than from them. Yes, we do believe that they are smart, they are brilliant, and etc. But still, we need to help them nourish those skills in a very safe community, in a caring community. We want our children, when they go to school, they feel safe. So it's okay if I'm angry and the teacher will understand. We want our children to know that, you know, I can talk to my teacher without having this fear that she might punish me. I can express my feelings and tell her that I don't feel okay today, but I promise to be okay the other day. We want the children to learn in a classroom where they have voice and a choice. You might think this is a bit difficult because we have curriculum, we are following certain policies. Fine, but when we ask children to have a choice, it's okay to give them, you know, a list of choices and let them choose from this list. Then you're still within the framework that you want to teach and within the learning outcomes that you want to achieve by the end of the semester or by the end of the year. So we want our children to be able to teach, learn, and lead. How many of our children now can work collaboratively in teams? How many of them are willing? They are willing. If you ask, I have students in the college now, and when I ask for a pair work or a group work, some of them are reluctant to participate. They say, can I do this individually? Teacher, can I do this by myself? Can I choose my partner? So where does this come from? This comes from the culture of teamwork. We need to create this awareness that teamwork is really helpful, that teamwork will help us achieve better, that teamwork is not something that, you know, it's only me. We need them to learn that, you know, we are working on the character of the child. I am unique myself, but I will behave and act better among a group of people. Because if I am unique, she is unique, she is unique, okay, we can do a good job. So what we want to do is to focus more on the character of the children rather than the academics. I'm not saying ignore the academics. As I said, all the skills that will help our students, you know, perform well in their life, as you know, teachers, educators, in any job they will take, they are perfect. The skills of the 21st century are there on our curriculum, which is really great. But still, if we do not take care of our students, if we do not ask our students to be accountable and help them to be motivated, so this future work will not work anymore. So what I'm saying is that how many of our children differentiate between the me and the reflection of me as we? Right? So me reflects we. When we work together, we achieve better. We are one. So even in a group, sometimes if you put children in a group, they will try to be in control of everything. They will try to show the teacher that I'm the best one in the group. We need to teach them that me is a reflection of we and vice versa. They don't work separately. Separately is selfishness. We cannot be without me and me cannot be without we. We need to teach this skill to our students. This is what is missing in our students. Unless this is there in our curriculum, any teaching we will do might not give us the aspiring or promising expectations or results that we want to have. Most importantly, teachers. The teacher. Teachers nowadays, they are multitasking teachers. Right? I am a teacher, you are teachers, even as educators. We are asked to do many things in our jobs nowadays. We have lots of loads. Right? So unless the teacher is aware of his or her emotional intelligence skills, unless the teacher is able to control, to be self-aware, to be empathetic with other colleagues and other teams, to be able to collaborate, to be able to work in teamwork. So we cannot hope that the teachers would help our children achieve what we want them to achieve. So we know, again, talking about emotion, which is my field, that emotion is at the heart of teaching. And I always say to my students, if you don't have this passion for teaching, please spare the world and stay at home. how they teach. Teaching was the prophet's career. We know it's hard. We know it needs a lot of patience. We know it's a challenge. We know it's full of a lot of emotions. Many research is talking about teachers' research, about teachers' stress, burnt out, and other things are negative. But little research talks about teacher happy moments in the classroom. We do have happy moments in the classroom. And if you talk to any teacher now, she or he can share many happy moments. And those happy moments come from the children, giving you a paper, a card, a word, achievements, thanking you for something. Many happy moments in our classroom. We want those happy moments to continue. And we want those happy moments to go to more. We want those happy moments to go further and be, you know, something that we dream of. That our children will have balance between their IQ, the academic skills, and their social and emotional skills. I still have students now who can send an email to me without saying hi or bye or greetings, just the attachment with the PowerPoint. Khalas, for me, it's for me to figure out who is sending what. Though some of the students are A students, they are excellent students, and they think, I did not think, teacher, that it's important to address you because you know me from the email. Yes, I do know you. But those little skills, those little touches, is what we want our students to learn. How to talk to you as a teacher, how to be persuading in a conversation. Many of the students who come and present, like in Hamdan Award and in Sharjah Award, I have met excellent students, and think they were so brilliant, amazing students. Some of them have all the skills, they are able to persuade them. But you ask a question, God, they have all the reasons. They have all the skills. They don't give you a chance to doubt what he or she is saying. But then, little thing, you might, you know, he or she might freak out, right? They say, I'm not quite sure what this is, what you want, or this is what... We want our students to be confident of their knowledge. We want them to have the self-confidence, the self-esteem that will help them, you know, stand in any place, any time, without having to fear. We want them to be equipped with knowledge. And knowledge is our responsibility, but not only knowledge. So the student needs to learn in the school, in the community, in the class, at home, all the skills. And if we are not one hand, I'm not putting all the loads now on teacher. I cannot do this. Okay? So it's a connection, it's a circle. It's a circle. So we need, if we want those skills to be there, if we want better children, we need to have more parents-school meetings. We want to have more parents-teachers meetings. We want our child to see that my school, my parents working at one time. They work together. If the child feels safe that, you know, my teacher talks to my mom and my mom talks to my father and my father always in the school to check on me, so he feels safe. And he would be happy that some caring people there are waiting for him or her. At the end, I would like to leave you with this quote, that most people think they need to make a better world for their children, but the reality is we need to make a better children for our world. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Mona Abu Asali, on this valuable presentation. In fact, we summarize some points of this lecture, Doctor, as spoken on the new skills of the 21st century to create a set of values and to have four focus points that this student is a body and emotion, a soul and a mind. The body should be respected, the emotion should be respected by us and motivated, and the soul, we should specify the target for which we have to work to reach the objective. Also, the mind, it should be it should be involved, engaged in evaluating itself and what it has learned. Doctor has reminded me of a picture. We see the gazelle runs and the tiger runs after it, unless the gazelle is rapid and speedy and flexible, he will be caught by that tiger. But if he's equipped with these skills, which as told by Dr. Muna, we can succeed. She also has spoken about the challenges faced by the teacher. Today we are in the knowledge, the century of knowledge. The information may reach the student before the teacher. Our rulers have provided us with smart learning. He may find the feedback, he may find the information through smart education, smart learning, and the smart iPad. Therefore, the teacher should manage the knowledge. Now we open the floor for questions within 15 minutes. If there is any question, yes, please. I can't hear the speaker. I can't hear the speaker. Please give him a mic. Please, I haven't heard the question. Thanks for your question. I reply in Arabic because most of the attendees are Arabs here. Dear friend, the social hypocrisy is not accepted by anybody. The emotional intelligence means that you say your word, your strong word, at the right time and the right place, and to make the other feel that he's wrong and to make him feel that this is right, without hypocrisy, as we say. We learn this by practice. I cannot be hypocrite, and the emotional skill. When I was in teaching, I had teachers, female teachers. I used to tell the teacher that what you have done is very good, and I want her to find the fault done by her and how she can do it in a better manner. I can't tell her you are wrong, just bluntly, and I cannot say that you are perfect, and I know there are many faults. When I have the skills of the emotional intelligence, I can make the people feel the value of what he has or she has done, and on the other side, I tell him that there is a negative side in his work. In the name of God, the most gracious, the most merciful, I thank the management of the center for this presentation, for this seminar. I tell the doctor that there are some problems with the students. I can't hear the voice properly. Is there a social communication or not? Our students don't lack a social communication, and they are very daring, and they are not shy. The problem is the communication between the school and the home. This is the big problem. Thanks for your question. I know that there is a communication among these bodies, I know the awareness of the student. These expressions are sent through the social communication, social media are not so little. We as educators, we cannot control quality or number of those messages. When we speak about the emotional intelligence, they should communicate, but these communications should be more polite. I don't send whatever I feel, nor I write whatever I feel, but some students, what you say is right, some female students, I told them why you are always communicating through this device all the time, it is in your hand. Because they say that we can say whatever we can say face to face. Our students should learn how to control the communication, how to benefit, how to invest this power, this capacity as educators, as leaders. We have to make it more polite. Thank you very much. In the name of God, the most gracious, the most stable, Hisham Omar, director in the Ministry of Education, thank you for your positive presentation. The emotional intelligence is not easy a skill at all. It is a skill to manage the work among the students, not only the young students, but in our team work teams, it needs great capacity in appraising the capabilities in this society. Some look at the emotional intelligence that is a fault, that it diminishes or reduces the character of the person, that the emotional intelligence is contrary to realism. I have to say whatever I want, whatever I have in mind, without observing the feelings of other, whether they are young or adults. I don't want that we leave things as they are in the emotional skill, emotional intelligence, but we have to use a firm approach. What is the message of doctor who is expert in this aspect to this category, simple category, who look at the emotional intelligence as a contrary to realism? Some people look at the emotional intelligence is contrary to realism. On the contrary, the emotional intelligence means that you cannot behave without emotions when you speak to your child, your wife, your father, your coach, your boss. You have to be polite and you have to observe emotions. We live these emotions every day. What we want is to be to behave in better manners. We as adults, we can control our angry for many reasons, which may be internal, functional, career, jobs. I may lose my relation with my colleague. We may be able to control our emotions and our nerves, but our children need to learn how to control their emotions. And when we discuss, when we are in a seminar, how to accept each other, how to ask a question without hurting my colleague or to make fun of him. This is coming from our religion. It is not new, but how to convey such information, how to convey this experience to our children. If we don't have it as adults, we cannot convey. Therefore, the message is that these skills should be subject to many training courses in this skill. There are schools and studies based on emotional intelligence and daily lessons teaching the student how to lead a work team, how to express his emotions in certain instances. There are in some schools fathers and children come at the same class. The emotional intelligence is not a work paper, it is a practice. We have to show them the example in our behavior to convey the message to our students, then to ask them to behave in the same manner. Thank you. I don't hear the question. السائل regarding the emotional intelligence, we speak on communication and on the emotional intelligence. Communication is lacking, is missing. There is no communication. The voice is interrupted. I don't hear. Sorry. The voice is interrupted. No voice coming. الصوت غير مسموع. I can't hear the speaker. Please use the mic. Sorry, I can't hear the speaker, so no translation is done. Please.
ما في صوت. ما اسمع صوت.
I can't hear the speaker, sorry. لتعذر سماع الصوت. I can't hear the voice of the speaker. I can't hear the speaker. I'm sorry. I can't hear the speaker, I'm sorry. Please give her a mic. Still the voice is lost. In reply to your question, I don't say that communication is available or lost. I don't want look. Sadly, still there is goodness in our students, in our children. Maybe there is one chain is lost unless we work together, the school with the home, with the teachers. There will be one chain missing. The communication. Of course, we cannot change a parent because he's brought up like this, but we can change the mentality of our students. We can direct them. We can direct our students to the best they may have better skills and they may change their parents. Unless we do this, we'll be worse and worse. The first step is to make the students better because they spend more time at school, more time than their parents. Unless the student knows that the school accepts him and adapts with him and gives him good ideas, we'll never be able to improve. I don't want to speak about the objective manner you have been speaking in. I'm surprised that the seminar is in English. I thought the lecturer doesn't know Arabic, but I am surprised. Surprised that she knows Arabic better than us. Unless we respect our language in our country, it will be difficult. I'm sorry that I feel stranger in my country. Both of us are Arabs and all the audience are Arabs. Why we speak in English? Is it weakness of our language or weakness of ourselves in your dialogue? You are great. You are a genius. Would you please allow me to respond? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. For the lecture and the English language, I bear the responsibility because all my communications with them were in English, but some of the experts don't speak Arabic. It is my fault because Dr. Mona prepared her presentation in English. Then it is my responsibility because she knows Arabic. Ms. Mahra, my friend, I greet you and greet the Arabic language. It is our language. I respect our language. My students always tell me why you speak English. This is my specialization. I teach English, the Arabic language. They have its own experts and they are better than me in Arabic. I write poetry and I write essays. I am one of the promoters of Arabic language. Before asking the presentation, is it in English or in Arabic? The question was that I am ready to give my presentation in English, and I understood that it is a seminar in English, and all the attendees, whether Arabs or non-Arabs, and since the used language, the three lecturers will be in English. So I didn't want to be alone or to be different. Next time I'll give my presentations in Arabic language, standard Arabic language. This is last question. Please give me the chance to thank the doctor on her valuable presentation and the unique subject, which is better than our expectation. The emotional intelligence is very important, but I understood from the presentation that to include this emotional intelligence in the curriculum, but we know that each society has its own values and beliefs in the scientific disciplines. We use foreign approaches done for different societies. How can we teach the chains in our schools, such as Al-Ghad schools or the schools that adopt American curriculum or British curriculum and teach the books as they are, as they come from their publishers, or those schools that adopt the curriculum of the Ministry of Education that adapt these curriculums and change them into Arabic language? How can we adapt these two approaches, how to keep our privacy and with those who are teaching in English? Thanks, my friend, but I believe that there are not inconsistent with our culture. This is in our history, in our religion, in our culture. All these values are in our religion. We have this heritage. We have this heritage. We have these morals and manners. I can't hear the speaker. I can't hear the speaker. I don't see any contradiction. These skills are life skills. They speak about principles, about morals, about values. These are international and they are available in each culture. They are not, they don't contradict in our community and culture, and each school may take what suits them. These skills are life skills required for our children, whether in Arabic or in English. I hope I have satisfied your question. Now we close the first session. Thank you very much for listening. We'll have 15 minutes and have coffee, and we'll have a meeting with Dr. Omar after 15 minutes. Thank you very much.
إن شاء الله 10:45 نعود بإذن الله تعالى.